Oh, yes, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Welcome to the story behind the story. Oh, we got a great echo on the line. There it's gone. It's gone. Okay, Chase, thanks for getting us on and taking care of any technical difficulties. Folks, yeah, TGIF, it's Friday. Holy mackerel, and I don't have a funeral to go to. I don't have a wedding to go to. I don't have anything but a good radio show to do today. And oh, my heavens, news. Oh, yeah, golly. This just out from the Washington Post. Incredible story. As if the Snowden NSA disclosures were big. This is just, to me, just as big. Way to go, Washington Post. I mean, somebody's got to keep these people honest. Look, folks, Afghanistan, the war, so-called, in Afghanistan, the war in Iraq. Do you realize that there's just huge amount of equipment over there, something called MRAP vehicles. They're armored vehicles too. They're just a little bit less armored than a Sherman tank, okay? The models for these MRAPs, they average now. This is average cost of $500,000 each. I kid you not. $500,000 each. There are a total of 2,000. 2,000 brand new MRAP vehicles, armored vehicles. 2,000 brand new that haven't even been used. The word just comes in with this Washington Post story that 2,000 of them are going to be destroyed, shredded, and sold as scrap metal. I kid you not, folks. These mine-resistant transport vehicles, mine-resistant MRAPs, my goodness, I guess it's better than having them deployed for homeland security. I guess we should count our blessings. The headline for the Washington Post reads, the U.S. military has destroyed more than $7 billion worth of military equipment before leaving Afghanistan next year. Quote, this is the largest retrograde mission in history. And let me quote you the story in its entirety. The U.S. military has destroyed more than 77,000 metric tons of military equipment, including mine-resistant troop transport vehicles, so-called MRAPs, as it prepares to withdraw from Afghanistan in late 2004, the Washington Post reported today. More than $7 billion with a B, $7 billion worth of military equipment is no longer needed or would be too expensive to ship back to the United States. So much of it is being shredded and sold locally as scrap metal. The Washington Post reported, citing U.S. military officials. Donating all the gear to the Afghan government is difficult because of complicated bureaucratic rules. Plus, U.S. officials do not believe the Afghans could maintain the gear. Plus, it would also be too expensive to sell or donate the gear to allied nations because of the cost of getting the equipment out of Afghanistan. Items being shredded by contract workers from Nepal and other countries for sale as scrap metal, and food, mine-resistant, ambush-protected MRAP vehicles, the Washington Post said. More than 24,000 MRAPs, mine-resistant, ambush-protected vehicles, were built for troops in Iraq and Afghanistan beginning in 2007 in a crash program that cost some $45 billion, according to Pentagon figures. The MRAP's V-shaped hulls help deflect the force of explosions, and the vehicle's higher chassis keeps troops further from the main force of the blast from improvised explosive devices, IEDs. U.S. commanders believe the MRAPs help save thousands of soldiers' lives and cite figures that show the number of casualties from IEDs dropped more than 80% after the vehicles were introduced. Some 2,000 of the 11,000 MRAPs in Afghanistan have been labeled excess, the Post reported. Quote, "We're making history doing what we're doing here," Major General Kurt Stein, who was overseeing the Afghanistan drawdown, told the newspaper. Quote, "This is the largest retrograde mission in history." When the U.S. military withdrew from Iraq, it drove much of its gear across the border into Kuwait, sent it back home on ships, or donated it to the Iraqi army, which has the infrastructure to maintain vehicles with complicated mechanics. U.S. officials, however, told the Post they do not believe the Afghan army could maintain such vehicles or other sophisticated equipment. Okay. Folks. So what's the problem with this? First of all, $500,000 each, the price tag on these MRAPs. And you can't afford to ship them anywhere. You just turn them into scrap metal. Is that's a more inexpensive option? I'm sorry, folks. I don't get it. I just have to shake my head and do a little belly laugh. Let me just give you an idea. If a second-rate power in the Middle East were to receive these MRAP vehicles, they would simply rate them up at the top of the largest operators of armored vehicles in the entire world. And it's just okay to shred them. And I bring the story out because I want to remind you, the listeners, what happened in October of 2001. If you remember correctly, it was less than 3 weeks after September 11th when CNN reported the Northern Alliance of Afghanistan somehow got instantaneously trained to operate and drive not MRAP vehicles, folks. No, we're talking about the M1 Abrams tanks. I was appalled and shocked at the CNN coverage of these massive tanks rumbling down the dusty cobblestone streets of Kabul, operated by the Northern Alliance warlords, you see, to go fight the Taliban. You see, how in the world do you get M1 Abrams tanks, very sophisticated war machines, how do you get them from Fort Benning, Georgia or wherever, wherever they're stockpiled, how do you deploy them in just 3 weeks and get the Northern Alliance warlords trained on them in just 3 weeks? My goodness, that's some kind of miracle. But now, the Afghan army, the Northern Alliance, whatever they call themselves now, they just don't have enough sense. They don't have enough moxie to maintain these vehicles. What other, what, I mean, whatever they're selling, folks, if you're not, if you're buying it, let me know, because I've got a great bridge to sell you somewhere over the San Francisco Bay Area. Money's simply no object, I submit, when the dumbed-down goyim, which is you and me, folks, when we're paying the bill. Either that or there is no bill to pay. You know, it really is amazing when you have a printing press in your basement and you can make whatever money you want. I wanted to discuss this today, and I want to go back again and still cover the book that we discussed yesterday. But leading into this is important. You know, folks, you just can't print money unless you control the world economy. You got to have something called the world reserve currency, and you got to make it so that other nations have to deal in your currency. And that's all well and good if you own the printing presses, because, see, that's how you control inflation. But the economic reality is simply this. As the nations of the world get saturated with this bogus paper money and the bogus credits on a computer screen, you see, at some point in time, somebody has to pay the bill. Pay the bill for value added, whether it's an MRAP vehicle or an M1 Abrams tank or a drone cruise missile, folks. You have to pay the price somehow, somewhere. It will become due and payable. Now, at some point, you reach a saturation point. At some point, the nations of the world will say, wait a minute, we have way too much paper in our vaults, and we realize there's not enough gold to even cover it, anything of real intrinsic value. It's not there. You see, what are you going to do now, Federal Reserve banksters? What are you going to do now? Are you going to enlist the residents of Mars or some other planet? You're going to have an intergalactic reserve currency? Because the only way you can keep the Ponzi scheme going is to keep expanding the base of goyim, of stupid people. At some point in time, the planet has to say enough. And this is the big Achilles heel. At some point in time, the world is going to say, we can't continue. It's already reaching that saturation point, folks. China is reaching the saturation point. This is a little blip that went to the stock market yesterday. It dropped over 300 points. When that happens, folks, not if, but when, make no mistake, these banksters have it all figured out. You see, then it's time to go to a new currency, a new restructuring, a new shuffling of the deck. A new one-world currency. No, we can't deal with euros anymore. We can't deal with Chinese wongs or yens or, heavens forbid, the peso. You see, the only answer they're going to say is to have a one-world currency with a one-world bank, and that is most definitely the next step they will take. You see, the only way you can get away with destroying $2,500,000 vehicles is if you control the reserve currency. Because it really doesn't matter what the dollar figure is. And it's not a matter of taxpayers footing the bill. That's a big lie, folks. Oh, we got to worry about the deficit. We got to quit the spending. No, you're missing the whole point, folks. And taxes aren't what runs this government. No, the deficit spending is simply a blank check on ink to be produced in the basement of the Federal Reserve. People that think they know the economic structure, they can't answer this question. It's a simple question. Well, the national debt, who do we owe that to? I can't believe people have asked that to, China and other countries. No. No, China has bought trillions of dollars of debentures, of treasury bonds. Let's see, that's not what funds this country. It's the international cartel of banksters that control China's economy too. The numbers of world countries that they have not controlled is shrinking rapidly. Do you realize that, folks, one of the top on the list was Iraq? Now it's gone. Saddam Hussein refused to allow the international banking cartel to operate in Iraq. He refused to do so under orders of Donald Rumsfeld and others. He refused to let him do it, and that's why he was painted as a terrorist. Same with a guy named Muammar Gaddafi. Gaddafi adamantly refused to let the international banksters operate in this country. Thus, he was a terrorist. Thus, he was this crazy nutcase and had to go. It's just all propaganda, folks. Boy, I tell you, I've talked with Libyan nationals while the so-called revolution of Libya was ongoing, and they were just stunned. Now, they know, the people of Libya know, that you got foreign mercenaries coming in, high-paid foreign mercenaries, funded and backed by the CIA and the Mossad. Folks, how is it that a revolutionary group gets established in Benghazi and suddenly gets recognized by the United States and Great Britain and the United Nations Security Council, and their central bank is recognized as legitimate currency? How does that happen? The central bankers make it happen. And the last really remaining bastion against these Edomite, and I'll call it what it is, these are Edomite Jewish international banksters, is the country of Persia, which is known today as Iran. They're doing just fine, thank you, economically. They're doing just fine, regardless of the sanctions, regardless of the blockade of trade. And they're a hardworking industrial country, folks. And they believe in keeping their money honest and not being part of the national, international debt structures. And so they're a hated enemy. They're the enemy of the Edomite group that calls themselves Israel and the Wall Street bankers. They're the avowed enemy of them. And so you'll hear all the lies and rhetoric that they're building a mushroom bomb. Remember, that's the same story that Conda Sleazy Rice told the nation on Face the Nation to justify the invasion of Iraq. These weapons of mass destruction, we don't want to have the next terrorist attack on American soil be in the form of a mushroom cloud. And everybody said, oh, oh golly, you can't have that. Never mind that Iraq was in no way, shape, or form involved in the events of September 11th. In fact, according to Susan Lindauer, CIA agent to Iraq, just the opposite. They were very much appalled in giving information, intelligence information, concerning the real perpetrators of that event. My guess is they knew very well it was CIA and Mossad, and they knew very well that telling the story would put them square in the attack sites. That's exactly what's happened, folks. So here we have the NBA Finals. Each Finals game, they pay tribute to the heroes, the American men and women in uniform, protecting freedom. Folks, that's the biggest problem I have with the NBA. It's run by Jews. It absolutely is controlled by them. Do you think David Stern is Christian? The commissioner? Of course he's not, folks. And on the biggest stage, whether it's the Major League Baseball games, whether it's the NBA Finals, whether it's the NFL football teams, it's all the same. They're run by the same group. It's just flat out the way it is. That's professional sports. That's the pressure valve to keep the goyim occupied while literally all hell is breaking loose around them. Do a pretty good job. They're amazing that way. And so here we go. Do I know when the United States Federal Reserve note, they call the dollar, do I know when that will be pulled as the world's reserve currency? No, I do not know. My guess, though, it's sooner than many people think. Now, the only thing that's keeping the economy even barely gasping is this Federal Reserve note being the world's reserve currency. You see, every OPEC barrel of oil has to be priced in United States dollars. International currency is pegged to the dollar, but you see, the dollar is in trouble. Our manufacturing bases have been shipped to other countries. When the world reserve currency is no longer the dollar, when it becomes an international currency, maybe a new Chinese currency, whatever it may be, folks, the effect in just 24 hours will be incredibly devastating. Imagine, literally, folks, this is no exaggeration, imagine gasoline, because that will have to be the first thing that spikes. Imagine gasoline going to $15 to $20 a gallon to begin with. That's about where it will be valued. What do you think that will do to the rest of the economy? What will the stock market do? What will follow as your grocery prices are up? Do you think wages will increase to match it? No. It will make the Great Depression look like a Sunday school picnic. Now, that's the plan, folks. That is going to happen. It was explained to me back in 1984 by a guy named Paul Volcker, chairman of the Federal Reserve. He explained the agenda to myself and a few other people in Wall Street. He told us
specifically that the paper dollars in our billfold, and he pulled out a wad of them that were, I mean, a huge number of zeros on them, that they meant nothing. They were just fire starter for his cigar. His exact words, folks, this is worthless. It's nothing. It's for, and I quote, the consumption of the goy. Now, I didn't know at the time what goy meant. I didn't understand that it is a Yiddish Ashkenazim term. It's not Jewish. It's Yiddish. It's Ashkenazim. It's Eastern European, folks, and it simply means human livestock, human cattle. Because really, that's what we are to these elitists. We're nothing but a bunch of livestock to be fattened up and then taken to the slaughter. And if we're lucky, we'll be able to have a nice stall to live in while we're working to, like a plow horse, to plow their fields and to harvest their crops. In other words, folks, we're just simply serfs to the elite. That's the reality. I don't want to sound like some prophet of doom, because it really is not going to be that bad if, and I emphasize if, a paradigm change of thought is made. You see, we have nothing to fear but fear itself. Indeed, that's a true statement. Understand this important point. Your checks from the government, those of you that receive transfer payments, welfare checks, food stamps, it's just paper. Your mortgage to the bank is just an electronic entry in a computer. Think about it, folks. All the paper money is just a simple means of exchange, a means to help with trade, to sell goods and services. You think about that as we take a break. We'll come back and go into this in more depth after these messages. But please do stay tuned. Don't go away.
Ronnie McMullen here for Life Change Tea. Everyone loves us for our all-natural tea that helps you with your health in so many ways. But many of you maybe don't know about our other beneficial products that can get your body on track and promote awesome health. Check out our Artaquil for immune boost, our sea vegetables for balancing your pH and helping your thyroid. How about our famous bionic bands that protect you from EMFs and give you more strength and energy? There are many more products that will help you live your best life. Go to our website, getthetea.com. That's getthetea.com. Or you can call our friendly staff at 928-308-0408. That's 928-308-0408. With all the intentional changes happening in our air and water, we need all the help possible. Trust me, heavy metal poisoning is happening. Get equipped. Get ready. Get the tea. That's getthetea.com.
We interrupt this program for an urgent announcement. The power's gone and the lights are out. We now have an emergency situation. Time to light your emergency candles. Don't have any? Then it's time to order your supply of emergency grab-and-go candles from LisaKCandles.com. The emergency candles outperform even the most extreme conditions. They are soot and toxin-free and have a natural extended shelf life. The time is now, so don't delay. Have emergency candles from Lisa K. Candles ready when you need them, so you remain in the light and out of the dark. Go to LisaKCandles.com. That's Lisa, the letter K, handles.com. Or call 731-441-3293. That's 731-441-3293. We now return you to your regular scheduled program already in progress.
What's better than Mountain House freeze-dried food? Buckets of Mountain House freeze-dried food. Now the freeze-dried guy introduces convenient, easy-to-store Mountain House survival buckets filled with our top-selling items. Each item is sealed in a Mylar-type pouch, and each pouch is neatly packed in clear buckets so you can easily see the contents inside. These Mountain House survival buckets come with well over a 25-year shelf life and are perfect for emergency preparedness, camping, backpacking, or at-home use. Go to freezedryguy.com, click on freeze-dried foods, and choose our 12-month, 6-month, 3-month, 1-month, or 7-day Mountain House Survival Bucket with 32 generous servings starting at just $69.95. And all orders to the lower 48 ship free. Call 866-404-3663 or go to freezedryguy.com. That's 866-404-3663 or go to freezedryguy.com. 100% veteran-owned. The Freeze Dry Guy.
Regardless of the dollar price involved, 1 ounce of gold would purchase a good quality man's suit at the conclusion of the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, the presidency of Franklin Roosevelt, and today. You may not be in the market for a new suit, but you don't know what the future may bring. And gold is the one financial constant the world has ever known. It can always provide you with your basic needs. Whether you're looking for junk silver, old silver dollar rolls, gold bullion, or fractional tradable gold pieces, Kettle Moraine is your full-service representative with over 50 years of knowledge and personal experience. Visit FlyingEagleGold.com or call us at 623-327-1778 today for competitive prices on all your gold or silver needs. If you're looking for real financial insurance, call Kettle Moraine today at 623-327-1778. That's Kettle Moraine, 623-327-1778.
The Micro Effect is the purest form of alternative news and information on the airwaves today. Be part of the effort to inform your fellow Americans about the things they need to know. Help us reach those that are looking for answers and truth about the world today. For a limited time, we are offering a dozen business card-sized magnets for every $25 contribution. Take a minute and go to our website and take a look at how neatly designed these magnets are. Pass them out or give them to your friends and neighbors. Let others know that we are speaking out and that they too have a voice of freedom. Once again, that's a dozen micro-effect magnets that are business card size for your $25 contribution. For those who are able to contribute more than $25, we have other offers, such as 30 magnets for a $50 contribution, or how about 75 business card size micro-effect magnets for $100. Help this network reach America 24 hours a day with your contributions. This is how we fight back with your freedom of speech. If you can't hear us, you're not listening.
Welcome back, folks. Welcome back to The Story Behind the Story. I'm your host, Dr. H. Ruat. Yes, indeed, the doctor is in the house. The doctor of, hopefully, you'll agree, that's the doctor of common sense. Folks, let's be real. What makes society tick? What makes America great? It's, number one, the people. What good is a country, what good is land if there's no people, if there's no humanity, if there's no society? Think about it. Would you really want to live in a land with just one or two people in it? Diversity and again, neighbors is what really makes a country great. The work ethic, the ability to provide value-added goods in a factory and the ability to provide needed services, whether it's a haircut, whether it's, yes, a doctor's medical advice or surgery, as the case may be. See, there's value-added goods and services. Now, to facilitate the transfer of goods and services, then you have duly appointed representative government. This is exactly what Muammar Gaddafi did and outlined in his book, The Green Book. It's what the founding fathers of America established, a republic, not a democracy. A republic is much different than a democracy, folks. The people, you see, form a government. Independent states are fine, but there must be a central government that has one responsibility. This is, again, if you really understand the writings of statesmen like Thomas Jefferson and Thomas Paine and others, okay, you understand the central role of government, number one, is to provide and make a standardized currency. Now, it doesn't matter if that is based on barrels of crude oil that it's brought out, you know, domestically. It just happens to be that, okay, gold and silver were used because, you see, gold and silver, silver may tarnish a little bit, but it doesn't decay. It doesn't spoil. It doesn't go bad. So it's a great medium of exchange. And so, okay, it's a value. It's a value pegged. See, this is important to understand. And with all due respect to my friend Bill Still, I mean, I hope he's finally gotten this. You need to establish a value base. You can't just go out and put out seashells or toggle switches or sticks. You know, you just can't do that. You have to have a base value. Now, if you set, as the founding fathers did in 1783, if you establish gold and silver weights as specific values for the paper currency, and you've got a value that you can know will never change. Folks, in 1783, a United States paper dollar was equal to little under 1 ounce of silver. In 1962, the ounce of silver was the same value for a dollar. It was pegged to it. Does that mean we have to have X number of silver dollars circulating in the currency? No, we just have to have a value pegged to that $1 bill. That's called honest currency. From 1783 to 1962, the price of silver and gold was constant with the value of a dollar bill. One of the first things that Lyndon Baines Johnson did after taking the oath of office on Air Force One following the coup d'etat, the inside murder by the CIA and Mossad of JFK, was to resend JFK's order, Executive Order Number 11110, where he ordered the United States Treasury to once again print silver certificates in the form of a $2 denomination. And it's clear, I have a number of $2 silver certificates from 1962, because they're collector's items. It says there very clearly, this is redeemable in lawful money at the United States Treasury. What is lawful money, ladies and gentlemen? A lawful money is silver coinage. You see, unlawful money is money that's just flat out not pegged to any value whatsoever. Here's a fact that you have to remember, folks. In 1963, President John Fitzgerald Kennedy was going to Dallas primarily to address a trade show, a trade mart. And at this trade show, his undelivered speech was typed out and securely put into his jacket pocket for delivery. You should read that, folks. You absolutely need to know what was being, what he wanted to address the nation. Well, I'm just going to go ahead and see if I can bring it up. I'll have it ready for the second hour. Well, no, let's do it right now. I do have it here on my desk. Let me share it with you, folks, because it's huge. This is JFK's last speech that was never delivered. And it's important because what Kennedy was going to declare here was, okay, the country of America, the country of the USA, at this point in November of 1963, America was never greater than it was at this point. This is the apex of this country's greatness. And I'm talking about jobs. I'm talking about standard of living. I'm talking about literally a vibrant national economy. Never had it been greater. You have to understand that, folks. Here's the speech, and I can't deliver it like JFK did, but I'm going to try. He would have given it the afternoon of his assassination, November 22nd, 1963. Here is his speech. I am honored to have this invitation to address the annual meeting of the Dallas Citizens Council, joined by the members of the Dallas Assembly, and pleased to have this opportunity to salute the Graduate Research Center of the Southwest. It is fitting that these two symbols of Dallas progress are united in the sponsorship of this meeting, for they represent the best qualities, I am told, of leadership and learning in this city. And leadership and learning are indispensable to each other. The advancement of learning depends on community leadership. For financial, political support, and the products of that learning, in turn, are essential to the leadership's hopes for continued progress and prosperity. It is not a coincidence that those communities possessing the best in research and graduate facilities from MIT to Caltech tend to attract new and growing industries. I congratulate those of you here in Dallas who have recognized these basic facts through the creation of this unique and forward-looking graduate research center. This link between leadership and learning is not only essential at the community level, it is even more indispensable in world affairs. Ignorance and misinformation can handicap the progress of a city or a company, but they can, if allowed to prevail in foreign policy, handicap this country's security. In a world of complex and continuing problems, in a world full of frustrations and irritations, America's leadership must be guided by the light of learning and reason. Or else, those who confuse rhetoric with reality and the plausible with the possible will gain the popular ascendancy with their seemingly swift and simple solutions to every world problem. My goodness, isn't that where we're in today? Kennedy's speech they never delivered goes on. There will always be dissident voices heard in this land, expressing opposition without alternative, finding fault but never favor, perceiving gloom on every side and seeking influence without responsibility. Those voices are inevitable. But today, other voices are heard in this land, voices preaching doctrines wholly unrelated to reality, wholly unsuited to the 60s, doctrines which apparently assume that words will suffice without weapons, that vituperation is as good as victory, and that peace is a sign of weakness. At a time when the national debt is steadily being reduced in terms of its burden on our economy, they would single that debt as the single greatest threat to our security. At a time when we are steadily reducing the number of federal employees serving every 1,000 citizens, they fear those supposed hordes of civil servants far more than the actual hordes of opposing armies. Boy, folks, he's hitting the nail so square on the head here. Just wonder what would have happened if that coup d'etat had failed. I really do. He goes on, quote, "We cannot expect that everyone, to use the phrase of a decade ago, will, quote, talk sense to the American people, close quote. But we can hope that fewer people will listen to nonsense. And the notion that this nation is headed for defeat through deficit, or that strength is but a matter of slogans, is nothing but just plain nonsense. I want to discuss with you today the status of our security, because this question clearly calls for the most responsible qualities of leadership and the most enlightened products of scholarship. For this nation's strength and security are not easily or cheaply obtained, nor are they quickly and simply explained. There are many kinds of strength, and no one kind will suffice. Overwhelming nuclear strength cannot stop a guerrilla war. Formal pacts of alliance cannot stop internal subversion. Displays of material wealth cannot stop the disillusionment of diplomats subjected to discrimination. Above all, words are not enough. The United States is a peaceful nation, and where our strength and determination are clear, our words need merely to convey conviction, not belligerence. If we are strong, our strength will speak for itself. If we are weak, words will be of no help. I realize that this nation often tends to identify turning points in world affairs with the major addresses which preceded them. But it was not the Monroe Doctrine that kept all Europe away from this hemisphere. It was the strength of the British fleet and the width of the Atlantic Ocean. It was not General Marshall's speech at Harvard which kept communism out of Western Europe. It was the strength and stability made possible by our military and economic assistance. In this administration, and also it has been necessary at times to issue specific warnings. Warnings that we could not stand by and watch the communists conquer Laos by force, or intervene in the Congo, or swallow West Berlin, or maintain offensive missiles in Cuba. But while our goals were at least temporarily obtained in these and other instances, our successful defense of freedom was not due to the words we used, but to the strength we stood ready to use on behalf of the prince. Yes, welcome back to the second hour of today's story, Behind the Story. Ladies and gentlemen, yes, what I'm reading to you now is the speech that was in the coat pocket of John Fitzgerald Kennedy on the day of his death, November 22nd, 1963. This was a speech he was prepared to give to the Dallas Trade Mart, which would have, been, of course, been broadcast live on television across the country. It was a major speech opportunity for him. And it basically what he was doing is giving a report card of America's strength and power, which is unprecedented. It really has. If you look at the economic numbers, not driven by inflation, because really there is no inflation. If you have dollars that are tied to a basic value, inflation and deflation is just not an option. Now, he goes on to explain about his goals and desires in outer space, about what his vision is there to, again, expand learning and technology in space. He talks about the valuable weather and communication satellites. He says, I'll make it clear to all that the United States of America has no intention of finishing second to anyone in space. The speech goes on, this effort is expensive, but it pays its own way for the cause of freedom and for America. For there is no longer any fear in the free world that a communist lead in space will become a permanent assertion of supremacy and the basis for military superiority. There is no longer any doubt about the strength and skill of American science, American industry, American education, and the American free enterprise system. In fact, the day he gave this speech, America's education, and again, the level of the education process was so high. It was at its all-time high. Not so today, folks. In short, our national space effort represents a great gain in and a great resource of our national strength. And both Texas and Texans are contributing greatly to this strength. Here's what I wanted to really focus on. These are great words, folks. Absolutely the embodiment of really the last honest goodness in a president. I mean, it's just evident of what he did by his own words, and not so much by his words, but by his actions. The Treasury, for the first time since Lincoln, printing legal, lawful reserve notes, not Treasury notes, not Federal Reserve notes tied for the first time in decades to lawful money in the form of silver dollars. His speech says that he never gave. Here is what it said. Finally, it should be clear by now that a nation can be no stronger abroad than she is at home. Only an America which practices what it preaches about equal rights and social justice will be respected by those whose choice affects our future. Only an America which has fully educated its citizens is fully capable of tackling the complex problems and perceiving the hidden dangers of the world in which we live. And only in America, which is growing and prospering economically, can hope to sustain the worldwide defense of freedom, while demonstrating to all concerned the opportunities of our system and our society. It is clear, therefore, that we are strengthening our security as well as our economy by our recent record increases in national income and gross outputs, by surging well ahead of most Western Europe in the rate of business expansion and the margin of corporate profits, by maintaining a more stable level of prices than any of our overseas competitors, and get this, and by cutting personal and corporate income taxes by some $11 billion, as I have proposed, to assure this nation of the longest and strongest expansion in our peacetime economic history. This nation's total output, which 3 years ago was at the $500 billion mark, will soon pass $600 billion for a record rise of over $100 billion in 3 years. For the first time in our history, we have 70 million men and women at work. For the first time in our history, average factory earnings have exceeded $100 a week. For the first time in history, corporation profits after taxes, which have risen 43% in less than 3 years, have an annual level of $27.4 billion. Again, folks, this is real money now, not money hyperinflated. $400 a month, exceeding $100 a week in salaries. Folks, that's the equivalent today of $10,000 a week in buying power and purchase power. Indeed, you look at the statistics, when you adjust it for inflation, which inflation was never a problem until, you know, Lyndon Johnson took out the unpegged the value standard. The speech continues, quote, "My friends and fellow citizens, I cite these facts and figures to make it clear that America today is stronger than ever before. Our adversaries have not abandoned their ambitions. Our dangers have not diminished. And so our vigilance cannot be relaxed. But now, we have the military, we have the scientific, and we have the economic strength to do whatever must be done for the preservation and promotion of freedom. Our strength will never be used in pursuit of aggressive ambitions. It will always be used in pursuit of peace. It will never be used to promote provocations. and will always be used to promote the peaceful settlement of disputes. We in this country, in this generation, are by destiny rather than by choice the watchmen on the walls of world freedom. We ask, therefore, that we may be worthy of our power and responsibility, that we may exercise our strength with wisdom and restraint, and that we may achieve in our time and for all time the ancient vision of peace on earth, goodwill toward men. That must always be our goal. And the righteousness of our cause must always underlie our strength. For as it was written long ago, except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain. That was it, folks. That's the speech that was never given, was written but never given by Kennedy at the trademark. And I got to tell you, folks, it's been downhill from then. Now, I wanted to also share with you the key points of what he presented on November 18th, 1961, because something drastically changed from 1961 till 1963. On November 18th of 1961, you see, Kennedy was very vocal in telling people not to believe in conspiracy theories. Kennedy gave this speech. He said, quote, "In recent months, I have spoken many times about how difficult and dangerous a period it is through which we now move. I would like to take this opportunity to say a word about the American spirit in this time of trial. In the most critical periods of our nation's history, there have always been those fringes of our society who have sought to escape their own responsibility by finding a simple solution, an appealing slogan, or a convenient scapegoat. Financial crisis could be explained by the presence of too many immigrants or too few greenbacks. War could be attributed to munitions makers or international bankers. Peace conferences failed because we were duped by the British or tricked by the French or deceived by the Russians. It was not the presence of Soviet troops in Eastern Europe that drove it to communism. It was the sellout at Yalta. It was not a civil war that removed China from the free world. It was treason in high places. At times, these fanatics have achieved a temporary success among those who lack the will or the vision to face unpleasant tasks or unsolved problems. But in time, the basic good sense and stability of the great American consensus has always prevailed. Now we are face to face once again with a period of heightened peril. The risks are great, the burdens heavy, the problems incapable of swift or lasting solution. And under the strains and frustrations imposed by constant tension and harassment, the discordant voices of extremism are heard once again in this land. Men who are unwilling to face up to the danger from without are convinced that the real danger comes from within. They look suspiciously at their neighbors and their leaders. They call for a man on horseback because they do not trust the people. They find treason in our finest churches, in our highest court, and even in the treatment of our water. They equate the Democratic Party with the welfare state. The welfare state with socialism, and socialism with communism. They object quite rightly to politics intruding on the military. But they are anxious for the military to engage in politics. But you and I and most Americans take a different view of our peril. We know that it comes from without, not within. It must be met by quiet preparedness, not provocative speeches. Let us not heed these counsels of fear and suspicion. Let us concentrate more on keeping enemy bombers and missiles away from our shores, and concentrate less on keeping neighbors away from our shelters. Let us devote more energy to organize the free and friendly nations of the world with common trade and strategic goals, and devote less energy to organizing armed bands of civilian guerrillas that are more likely to supply local vigilantes than national vigilance. Let our patriotism be reflected in the creation of confidence rather than the crusades of suspicion. Let us prove that we think our country great by striving to make it greater. And above all, let us remember that, however serious the outlook, the one great irreversible trend in world history is on the side of liberty. And so for all time to come, are we. Okay, well, that's, boy, what a difference 2 years makes. It's really amazing when you read his Columbia University speech, or hear his speech given. Because, you see, suddenly he's specifically saying there is a massive conspiracy. It's quite amazing. You know, in all of these websites on JFK, there's very few that really will even post this speech given at Columbia University. It's really amazing. So let's go there. This is Columbia University given, I mean, the speech is amazing when you compare it with just what he gave in 1961. There's... the audio recording is really, really great. But anyway, we don't have a way to broadcast it. Let me just go ahead and give it to you. This is June 4th, 1963, is when Executive Order 11110 was issued. Ten days before his assassination, John F. Kennedy, on November 12, 1963, said these words. the high office, and I quote, the high office of the president has been used to foment a plot to destroy the Americans' freedom. And before I leave office, I must inform the citizens of this plight. Are you kidding me, folks? Do you understand this? Also, he said back again a few months earlier, the very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society, and we are as a people inherently and historically opposed to secret societies, to secret oaths, and to secret proceedings. My goodness, the Columbia University speech is also absolutely amazing when you say we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy. What could have possibly happened from 1961 to 1963 in those 2 years, two short years? Let me tell you something, folks. There was a visit to the Oval Office in 1961. This was originally scheduled to be a short meeting, but as the record shows, it expanded out to a three-day meeting. There was a Roman Catholic bishop that had a meeting with John Kennedy. This Roman Catholic was an Irish Catholic gentleman who had actually been the priest to the defense secretary of America, defense secretary James Forrestal. Forrestal, you see, was in communication with a general in Germany named George Patton. George Patton's communications to Defense Secretary Forrestal gave full disclosure on what was going on in occupied Germany, how the Bolshevik Jewish-controlled Russians were doing incredible atrocities to the German Christian people. George Patton's response was, he's very clear, and it was not politically popular. He says, this is clear, we are fighting the wrong people. We are imprisoning the wrong people. You know, the godless, atheistic Bolsheviks. My goodness. Torturing and killing and mutilating Christian Germans. Patton saw it, Patton reported on it, and Forrestal was trying to do his best to expose it and to stop it. When Forrestal was killed, Forrestal was brought under false pretenses to the Bethesda Hospital and was there for some kind of a medical procedure and was pushed out of an upper room window. He did not commit suicide. He did not jump. He was murdered. It just so happens that that James Forrestal was Roman Catholic, Irish Catholic, and had given confessional material in confidence to this priest, the same priest who now has a visit with the Roman Catholic, Irish Catholic president, John Fitzgerald Kennedy. And something happened after that. Something changed in the psyche of John Fitzgerald Kennedy. I mean, whereas, you know, I'm convinced that he was, you know, not the best man morally. Of course he had morality problems, he had adulterous affairs with the likes of Marilyn Monroe and others. He was not a saint. But I know that something happened in his speeches. Something drastically changed, whereas in the first year or so of his office, he was adamantly against any mention of any type of monolithic world conspiracy. It just wasn't there. But suddenly, he's more than aware of it, and he changes his stance against Israel, powerfully so, drawing a land in the sand against Israel's deployment and building of the Dimona nuclear facility. And in the strongest possible terms, he just like he stood up to Khrushchev and during the Cuban Missile Crisis, so too he stood up against David Ben-Gurion and the State of Israel. Whereas before, he was very much allied with them. What happened? What changed? What caused him to have such a dramatic turnaround? On June 4th, 1963, Executive Order number 11110 was signed. That order returned to the U.S. government the power to issue currency, the right to issue currency without going through the Federal Reserve. It was flat out a death knell. It was an absolute attack against the international banksters of the Rothschilds and those of Israel. President Kennedy's order gave the Treasury the power, quote, to issue silver certificates against any silver bullion, silver or standard silver dollars in the U.S. Treasury. What this means, folks, what this meant is that for every ounce of silver in the U.S. Treasury's vaults, the federal government could introduce new money into circulation. Kennedy brought $4.3 billion in real U.S. notes into circulation. You see what was happening? With the stroke of his pen, John Fitzgerald Kennedy was well on his way to putting the Federal Reserve Bank of New York out of business. You see, and it's brilliant because the same thing has to happen now. If you want to get this country back and make sure we don't have a destructive fall economically, somebody has got to come forward with the same exact agenda. Somebody has got to have a platform, and somebody's got to tell the truth about really who's running, who's jerking the strings of our politicos behind the scenes. It's not enough, Mr. Ron Paul, to say, audit the Fed, audit the Fed. No, no. You got to get rid of the thing, and you got to do it in the same way JFK did it. And you got to have a bunch of bulletproof vests. You see, let the law of supply and demand work. If enough U.S. Treasury, honest, you know, not being charged interest, you see, on the circulation, the Federal Reserve notes become absolutely toilet paper, as well they should. Because that's all they really are. Executive Order number 11110 would absolutely have eliminated the national debt completely. You see, no interest, no nothing. Folks, that's the reality. I'm going to share with you when we come back the exact wording of Executive Order 11110. Don't go away. You're going to have to crack in a grasp on this if possible. Thank you. Thank you.
What's better than Mountain House freeze-dried food? Buckets of Mountain House freeze-dried food.
Now the freeze-dried guy introduces convenient, easy-to-store Mountain House Survival Buckets filled with our top-selling items. Each item is sealed in a Mylar-type pouch, and each pouch is neatly packed in clear buckets so you can easily see the contents inside. These Mountain House Survival Buckets come with well over a 25-year shelf life and are perfect for emergency preparedness, camping, backpacking, or at-home use. Go to freezedryguy.com, click on freeze-dried foods, and choose our 12-month, 6-month, 3-month, 1-month, or 7-day Mountain House Survival Bucket with 32 generous servings starting at just $69.95. And all orders to the lower 48 ship free. Call 866-404-3663 or go to freezedryguy.com. That's 866-404-3663 or go to freezedryguy.com. 100% veteran-owned. The Freeze Dry Guy.
Okay, folks, here's the truth. I hate the word fat. How about you? Call it extra weight, burritos, double donuts, muffin top, porky, spare tires. It's just plain irritating. What to do? If you eat a lot of corn, flour, or sugar, there's garbage that goes with eating those foods. So here's a remedy. Life Change Tea. Drink our tea and watch unwanted pounds leave. Fat is like crud. Let Life Change Tea clean your insides and remove the crud. Many customers have lost over 30 pounds. Weight loss varies by how much weight you carry. Health in this day and age should be your number one priority. Don't wait. No pun intended. GetTheTea.com. Order now. Our tea tastes great. And watch it go to work on you. Log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. Or you can call 928-308-0408. Don't wait. 928-308-0408. Or log on to GetTheTea.com.
Interrupt this program for an urgent announcement. The power's gone and the lights are out. We now have an emergency situation. Time to light your emergency candles. Don't have any? Then it's time to order your supply of emergency grab-and-go candles from LisaKCandles.com. The emergency candles outperform even the most extreme conditions. They are soot and toxin-free and have a natural extended shelf life. The time is now, so don't delay. Have emergency candles from Lisa K. Candles ready when you need them, so you remain in the light and out of the dark. Go to LisaKCandles.com. That's Lisa, the letter K, candles.com. Or call 731-441-3293. That's 731-441-3293. We now return you to your regular scheduled program already in progress.
You can feel that squeaky clean sensation like none other with Vitamer toothpaste and mouthwash. Vitamer toothpaste and mouthwash is a unique natural formula not found in any other oral care products. With a gentle combination of zinc, folic acid, myrrh, and clove oil, Vitamer effectively whitens teeth, removes plaque, and freshens breath, and it does it naturally without any harmful chemicals. Visit us online at Vitamer.com. That's VitamyR.com. Or call us today to place your order at 1-888-558-8482. That's 1-888-558-8482. 8482. Keep your teeth and gums healthy with Vitamer toothpaste and mouthwash. Vitamer, nature's answer to healthy teeth and gums. And remember, it's all completely natural. Available at participating health food stores nationwide.
You're listening to The Micro Effect. We didn't get here by chance. Our existence is no mistake. We got here because America needs what we provide, and that's information. Information that can be used in your daily lives. While we're waiting for others to wake up and realize that they, too, need the information we provide, your support is needed to keep us going 24 hours a day. This is no easy task we've burdened ourselves with, and we have created a network of those who will continue to keep you up to date with the current events and actions that people should be aware of. No one here gets a paycheck. Everyone here contributes their all and more. All we need is your support to keep going. So make it count by making a contribution to our efforts, and our promise is we'll make our effort count. You can't stop America when everyone is pulling together. The Micro Effect.com. Call 888-747-1968. Make your contribution today at P.O. Box 164, Kamiai, Idaho 83536, or on the web at www.themicroeffect.com.
I'm a man
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the final segment of today's Story Behind the Story. This is, I'm telling you, this is critical, critical information to absorb and understand. It truly is. Let me just share with you what Abraham Lincoln did in 1865 that got him assassinated, as well as what JFK did that got him assassinated. And this is not conspiracy theory, folks. This is conspiracy science. Abraham Lincoln had a learning curve to go through. He had to be educated as well. He didn't come in understanding monetary policy to it, but you know what? He was a brilliant, brilliant mind. Reading his papers and his journals, completely brilliant. My goodness, nobody thinks like Lincoln, in my opinion, anymore. Very few people do, let's put it that way. You see, Lincoln had received intelligence reports from the secret police of the Tsar Nicholas. The Russian Tsar gave full disclosure from credible sources the whole agenda of the House of Rothschild, the French House of Rothschild, the British House of International Bankster Rothschilds, the whole plan to divide and conquer and to slaughter Christians. Civil War resulted in 730-some-thousand dead American men, many of them in the prime of their life. I can just imagine Lincoln at the Battle of Gettysburg when he gave his Gettysburg Address, and then learning really who was behind this whole insanity. And so he put out emissaries to Jefferson Davis and the Carolinas, and said, "Really, do we understand what's going on? Let's patch this thing up. Let's let him up easy." He told his generals, because you saw the machinations, the manipulations by foreign agents. Agents of a most despicable and dastardly international banking cartel. So Lincoln, folks, you can do your own research. Please don't just take what I'm telling you with a grain of salt. Just learn and do your own study. This is Senate Document 23. Page 91 specifically. Page 91, Senate Document 23 outlines Abraham Lincoln's monetary policy and his orders as he outlined it following the surrender of Lee at Appomattox Courthouse, 1865. Here it is, folks. And boy, he had it right on the nose. He wrote, when I quote, "Money is the creature of law and the creation of the original issue of money should be maintained as the exclusive monopoly of national government." Boy, that one sentence is absolutely most powerfully important. It's the exclusive monopoly of national government, not private banks. Money possesses no value to the state other than that given to it by circulation. Now think about that. That is very, very powerful as well, that sentence. Capital, you see, has its proper place, Lincoln wrote and declared. Capital has its proper place and is entitled to every protection. Let's define capital. Capital is, again, wealth
created by value-added goods and services. That's the definition of capital. And is entitled to every protection by who? By the national government, you see. And so the wages of men should be recognized in the structure of and in the social order as more important than the wages of money. What does that mean, folks? The wages of money. They're talking about interest by private banksters. You see, when you have a system of phony money and money becomes the master instead of the servant, you displace the wages to men. Very, very, very powerful economic words here. Absolutely, incredibly true principles. No duty is more imperative for the government than the duty it owes the people to furnish them with a sound and uniform currency and of regulating the circulation of the medium of exchange so that labor will be protected from a vicious currency and commerce will be facilitated by cheap and safe exchanges. Okay, let's dissect that sentence. The government is there to serve the people. It owes the people one primary thing, and that's to furnish them with a sound and uniform currency. What is a sound and uniform currency? That it, you see, it has to be pegged to value. It has to be. Otherwise, it's not uniform and it's not sound. And then you got to regulate the circulation of that currency. In other words, you can't flood it. You can't print out more currency than the gross domestic product, the output, goods and services, the total value. If you do that, you've got inflation. If you're under that, you have deflation. Either is a problem. So you've got to regulate it, and that means being honest. That means having integrity. If you have an exchange that's safe and inexpensive, who benefits? Business, commerce, and the people benefit. It's really a basic principle as gravity. Now here's an important second point. Really, you've got to get this, folks. The available supply of gold and silver being wholly inadequate to permit the issuance of coins of intrinsic value or paper currency totally convertible into coin in the volume required to serve the needs of the people, some other basis for the issue of currency must be developed. And some means other than that of convertibility into coin must be developed to prevent undue fluctuation in the value of paper currency or any other substitute for money of intrinsic value that may come into use. Now, folks, that's what I'm talking about here. You've got to peg it to gross domestic output and product, value-added goods, manufactured goods, harvested goods and farm output, factory output, livestock, oil production, all these things, you see, go into the equation. If you have the government issuing that as a service and not having interest on it, which is, again, what the Federal Reserve has done, that is a recipe for economic prosperity for the people. And it's a death toll for those who would abuse the system, which are the same people that fomented the Civil War in the first place. Lincoln understood this. Americans aren't aware of this. They are blissfully ignorant of this. Now, you've got to have the currency value pegged to gold and silver. That's what the founding fathers knew. You have to have it pegged, and that's a fantastic way to do it. A dollar bill issued by the government has X number of value grams of silver or X grams of gold. That's its value. Not everybody's going to come and turn in. Let's say you have $500 million in gold and silver and $500 billion in currency. Nobody's going to come and demand all the gold and silver. It just has to have a value that's solid and pegged. You see, based on, again, the output, the production, the work, goods and services produced by the people. That's the formula. Lincoln wrote, quote, "The monetary needs of increasing numbers of people advancing towards higher standards of living can and should be met by the government. Such needs can be served by the issue of national currency and credit through the operation of a national banking system, the circulation of a medium of exchange issued and backed by the government can be properly regulated and redundancy of issue avoided by withdrawing from circulation such amounts as may be necessary for by taxation, redeposit, and otherwise. Government has the power to regulate the currency and credit of the nation." Now, it's eerily similar to exact same wordage in Muammar Gaddafi's Green Book. Absolutely, Gaddafi understood the principle of honest currency. Those of you that think that Muammar Gaddafi was this monster, this dictator, this ruthless killer, you might as well believe that the 9/11 was perpetrated by a guy in a cave in Bora Bora. It's a big lie, folks. All you have to do is read his Green Book. I mean, you can find it free online. Just type in Gaddafi's Green Book. You'll see a number of websites that have it. It's not a terrible read. It's quite interesting. It takes you all of 3 or 4 hours at the max. Man, I tell you, it parallels Abraham Lincoln and Thomas Jefferson to the letter. It's amazing. It's brilliant, folks. I'm telling you. The powers that be want you to believe that this is all just bunk. That it's just nothing but tripe. Of course they do. They have their agenda of New World Order to protect. Lincoln continues, quote, "Government should stand behind its currency and credit and the bank deposits of the nation. No individual should ever suffer a loss of money through depreciation or inflated currency